Okay.
We'll have a word of prayer and we'll move forward. Father, we thank you for this grace. We thank you for this love. All of the provisions that you made for us, that you have blessed us. Hallelujah. Every blessing, heavenly places. You've given us everything that pertains unto life. Thank you, God, for all the victories. And thank you for all of your promises. You're all you have in there. For the devil has failed one word of all of your promises. Your promises are sure to every seed and to every regeneration. Lord, we thank you for your word. It's forever settled in heaven. Never return void. Will always accomplish the purpose that you have set it to accomplish. You will prosper everything whereunto it is sent. Father, we thank you for beginning the good work within us. You who have begun the good work, you shall continue to perform. You have not failed. There hasn't failed one word. All of your good promises to us. Lord, we know that your word is reliable. Your counsels of old are all faithfulness and truth. Lord, we thank you today. Hallelujah. For victory, the victory, the victory, the victory that overcome, the victory that overcome. This is the victory that overcome, even our faith. Give you praise and the glory. Hallelujah. Every provision, every hallelujah. Bless all that you've done for us through Christ. All that you have done, Father, through your grace. Your grace. Your grace is sufficient to man. And you're able, God, to stand to whatever measure of grace is needed. Able to cause whatever measure is needed to abound toward us. So we will have sufficiency in everything. Lord, we thank you today. We'll say to this. Defeated, he's under our feet. We've been delivered from the power of darkness. Hallelujah. We've been placed in the kingdom of Jesus. Jesus is our Lord. He's our King. He's our mediator. He is our intercessor. And he ever living to make intercession for us. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name, thank you, Lord, for beginning the good work in us. And you who begun the good work, you shall continue to perform. Father, we thank you for the good work in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. I want to just read some of the scriptures. On page 88 of this book here, I just want to make sure that if you're not reading it, I want to make sure that you hear it. Show you that what you have at your disposal, and how important it is for you to recognize the finished works of Christ, the finished work of Christ. Maybe we could break the finished work of Christ down, and it's going to be reflected in building the highest type of faith through declaring and acknowledging God's word. We're going to see all of the things and benefits God has blessed us with through his redemptive work. First of all, I would like to mention that the greatest achievement that has ever been made on behalf of mankind is the achievement of reconciling lost humanity, lost man, back to Christ. It's the biggest single achievement that has been made. I guess that would be a spiritual achievement that has been made on our behalf, reconciling man back to Christ. Because when man was alienated, his fellowship broken, and he became a partaker of spiritual death. The most important issue, man's greatest need at that point was eternal life. having man eternal life, but in order for man to have eternal life, he has to be restored back to God or made righteous. Amen. When we say reconciled back to God, that means man has to be brought in right standing with God, and man has to receive eternal life. Amen. And let's look at the scripture. I would say the greatest victory that has ever been won on our behalf was Jesus' conquest over Satan. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Amen. He just completely paralyzed his power. And he, all of his principalities, powers, and all of the rulers, and all of his hierarchy was absolutely paralyzed and destroyed. The greatest victory that has ever been won. Everybody agree? All right, everybody agree with that?
Yeah.
And the greatest blessing that I would say the greatest inheritance that have ever been received, the greatest inheritance that have ever been given is when Christ, Jesus, inherited everything that he had created as God, as man. That's confusing. Jesus inherited everything that God had created for man initially. It was Adam, is that right? All right, how many know that Adam was blessed when he was created? Everything that pertains to life and to godliness, everything that Adam ever longed for, needed, he had it at his disposal. Is that right? God had given him everything that he needed. So when Jesus was raised from the dead, the Bible mentions about Jesus because he was the firstborn that was ever, he was the firstborn among the dead. He was the first person that had ever experienced what spiritual recreation. He was the first one that was born again. He was born out of spiritual death. And when he was born, since he was the firstborn of every creature, he inherited all things. Amen. Turn to Hebrews. You will see that. Hebrews 1. He inherited all things. So the greatest inheritance that has ever been received, amen, Jesus received as a man was when God said, "This day have I begotten thee," and he said that he inherited a name above all names. So it was a great inheritance that Christ received when he triumphed over Satan. He took the authority back, right? All right. He took the authority back, and he defeated and spoiled all of Satan's armor that he trusted in, all of his welfare, the principalities and powers and rulers and all of those. They were completely confiscated. They were defeated. They were paralyzed. And although those are the things that we wrestle with today, but they've been defeated, and God wants us to know that Satan's what? Army have all been what? Defeated. He wants us to know that. And because we don't know that, many times we suffer the consequences of not being able to deal with these forces that are still in operation, but they have been what? Defeated. And our battle is not with flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers. But it's not a physical fight. It's not a fight that we're trying to get victory. It's a fight of faith. And we have to know what we have and who God has made us and what Christ has done in order for us to be successful in our fight. Amen. With the enemy. Amen. Life is says, greater is he that is what?
In us.
In us than he that is what?
In the world.
In the world. I'm just going to show you what I'm speaking about. The greatest achievement that has ever been accomplished is this. Second, I'm going to give you Colossians 1. And this is the thing that makes you really happy. And this is what all of these affirmations are about. It's going to fit because we said Hebrews 1. I don't want to read that one before we get too far. Okay, 1:4. Being so much better than the angels as he had by inheritance, obtained a more excellent name than they. All right, the inheritance that Christ received, obtained was the inheritance of the things that were lost through Adam. These were the things that were lost through Adam. All of the blessings, all of the benefits, all of the spiritual and natural blessings, everything that pertains to life and unto godliness. These things were lost through Adam, but they were regained through Christ. And because they were regained through Christ, then he was able to give those things over to what? To those that have been what? Have been born again. Those that have received him. As many has received him, to them he has given them what? The authority to become the sons of God. So everything that we lost through Adam, everything that was stolen, has been regained. So we are blessed with all things. We are blessed with things too. You only we have just more than authority.
Amen.
Power over the devil. We have more than a reconciliation. But we have what? All things that were lost through the fall, we have been what? They have been restored and given back to us. That's the reason why we have been made heirs of God and what?
Joined
us. He had to do it as a man. He had to receive it back as a man. That's the reason why he had to come into flesh. So he could what? He could, through death, destroy the power of the one that what? Held the power over the human race, which is Satan. And he did that, and he took back everything that was what? Lost. Through Adam. So when we get born again, when we get saved, and when we get filled with the Holy Spirit and receive a knowledge of the Word, knowledge of God's Word, then those things that we lost through Adam, all of those things begin to manifest again in our lives. Amen. So we are blessed with every spiritual blessing.
Amen.
How many can say amen?
Amen.
We are blessed. Everything lost through the fall has been what? Regained through what? Everything lost through the first Adam has been restored through who?
Jesus
Christ. Amen. So Brother Wayne talked about the riches of the glory of the inheritance, which is of the saints. And we don't know how rich we are. Just look at all of y'all here tonight. All right, all of those riches and provisions that I'm speaking about is in these areas that we have asked you to meditate. All right, the first area is I believe the first area we talked about was, this is what reconciliation is all about. This is what Christ's victory over Satan was all about. This is what about him receiving that, obtaining that inheritance that was lost so he could turn around and what give it to us is all about. Amen. All of these scriptures kind of breaks it down and lets you know that what all of these blessings that you have received are all about, and is the riches of the glory of the inheritance, which is in the saints. The saints are very rich. Just looking at you here tonight. Everybody got a different talent, different gift, different endowment, different everything. I mean, just think of the riches of the glory that God, Bible says, Christ in you, what, which is what? The hope of glory. I mean, you know, sometimes God reveals such things to us. Is that right?
Yeah.
I mean, how many have experienced all types of miraculous interventions of God in your life recently?
Man,
just recently. I mean, all types of things just keep what happened. Amen. So the Bible says he daily loaded us with what? Benefits. His mercies are what? New every morning. Is that right? Amen. Just think about all the different gifts. Like Sister Irene is gifted to, I meant to talk. And Brother Wayne, you know, last Monday night, he got up and started talking about Psalms 77, everybody. And just blessed everybody's socks off.
Amen.
All of that. Yeah. Knowledge and wisdom and revelation, inspiration and zeal and fervor. All of this is on the inside of us. Our Bible says we have obtained an inheritance. Well, how many believe that you got a great inheritance? Heirs of God and what? Joint heirs with Christ. All of these blessings, you know, they were restored to us through Christ. I just wanted to try to get your attention about the three areas that we want to really keep in mind when we begin to think about what Christ has done for us in the heart. And they will be reflected in our release from Satan's power, the life, ability, and fullness we have received, the made able ministers and co-laborers with Christ, our right standing with God, which is righteousness. You know, that's a real deep subject. Mm-hmm. And the grace and love of God. All of this has been, the Bible says, has been received. The Bible says been in Romans 5. The love of God has been what? Shed abroad in our what? Hearts. By what? The Holy Ghost. Amen. We have received all of these things that I'm reading off here, that I've asked you to meditate, that I've asked you to begin to what? Affirm, because it's going to reflect all of these redemptive things that that I have mentioned, that Christ has actually given us or blessed us with. So we said the greatest achievement that has ever been accomplished in the spirit realm is our reconciliation back to Christ. That happened from the time that he became, amen, he left his, well, the Bible says that he emptied himself of his outward powers, held on to his inward powers, like holiness, and, you know, those are divine, but he emptied himself of all of those outward powers, like his omnipotence, his, what else, his glory, his authority, and all of these things that he, that made him God, he relinquished that to come become man. Of course, he didn't relinquish his holiness. You know, he didn't do that. But his outward powers, he did. But he had to come to identify with man so he could reconcile man back to God. And let me just give you the scripture that we like to read. Colossians 1:21. Because the same thing, okay, the greatest achievement that, that has ever been made was our reconciliation. The greatest victory that has ever been won is Christ's defeat over what? Satan and all of his cohorts. That's the greatest victory that has ever been won. Amen. And that's the reason why Jesus is our champion. And we have the power and authority that we have because Jesus stripped Satan of the authority that he had stolen from Adam. And he has given that authority back to what? Back to us. So the greatest conquest in human history, the has ever been won is Christ's victory over what? Satan. Everybody, the whole world recognizes that. Right? Amen. The whole world recognizes that Jesus is what? Lord. And he has triumphed over what? Satan, death, hell, and what? The grave. Soon we're going to be celebrating what? Easter. Which means what? The resurrection of what? Christ. How many glad?
Yes.
Isn't that enough to dance all around in here?
Yes.
Amen. I'm happy enough to just start running down through. Praise God. That was a great victory. All right? And the greatest gift that we have ever received is what? Amen. All those, that great inheritance that Christ, what? Amen. He was, what? He received inheritance. Amen. All that was lost through Adam was restored through Christ. I mean, the Bible says Jesus became poor, that through his what? Poverty, that we might be what? Rich. I mean, these are material things as well. These are everything that you need in order for you to be what? More than a conqueror.
Yeah.
Those things have been restored through us. Amen. And Jesus had to do it and restore it to us through as a man. That's the reason why he had to defeat Satan as a man. Amen. So that he could be given that inheritance back. He could receive that inheritance back as a man so that he could pass it on to what? You and I, all of us. So we are really blessed. Okay, I'm going to start with, now if you would look at what I just said, that we have received inheritance because Christ, being the first one that was raised from the dead, that was born out of death, the firstborn of every creature, he was the one that received eternal life, the first one to receive eternal life after being united with Satan, you know, when he became sin. So he was born out of death, out of spiritual death. All right, so being the firstborn from death, he inherited what? All that was lost through Adam. Being born out of spiritual death, he inherited all that was lost through Adam. So that as a man, he could give it back to us, who Satan what? Took it from. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Does it make sense?
Yeah, but
all right.
Whom Adam gave the authority to, unlawfully gave it to Satan, and now man is lost. And Christ came back and regained it, so that man could have it again.
There you go. All right.
So how we act like that?
How we act like that? Why we act like that?
No. How do we act like that?
Act like we have received.
Sons of God.
Yeah, that's what we're trying to get to. We're trying to show you.
I'm trying to find it. You know what I'm saying?
Okay. Hold on. How we get it, you know, the other day I was reading, E.J. McKinyon, he was speaking about under the old covenant, you know, they operated with a limited righteousness. And although with a limited righteousness, they were able to accomplish all because they were in blood covenant relationship with the Lord, right? I mean, all these prodigies and miraculous things that happened under these men, just name them, Abraham, Moses, name them, all of them, Joshua, stopping the
David,
the son,
Gideon,
David. I mean, today I was reading about David and how all of these miraculous things. You know, David was the one that gave us a lot of the messianic Psalms, 22, 28, and even the coming kingdom when Christ would be reigning again, you know, in Jerusalem and all of that. David gave us all of that. I mean, he had great revelation. David gave us 90% of all of the information that we have on worship.
Yeah, but how you get there?
Okay, now that's the point I'm trying to get to.
Okay.
Okay. And that was under the Latin covenant, it was a limited righteousness. Amen. It was based on the blood covenant, the value that God had placed on the blood of goats and calves and things like that. It was just a limited righteousness. They were reckoned righteous, but they were not what really righteous. No, they were what servants. They were not sons. We are what? We are sons. Okay, but so we have a better covenant, better sacrifice, better blood. Is that right? So we have unlimited righteousness. Okay. And then you said you never would know it. All right, but we have unlimited righteousness. We are not servants as they were. We are what? Sons. Right?
Children.
And God's grace, the Bible says he would be very gracious to us after our reconciliation, or after we'll restore it back. So God is able to do a jillion times more through us and for us than he was able to do through what those servants. Because we are what? Sons.
Yes.
So he has restored back to us, reconciliation has restored back to us what? Eternal life. So God doesn't have to deal with us through the sacrificial system, the offerings that they've made, and what else? The angelic visitations and what?
Please.
Visions and dreams, you know. God doesn't have to deal with, you know, we don't have to experience to enter God's presence today. We don't have to what? We have a what? A higher and better what? What?
Yes.
Amen. Because all we have to do, amen, we have Christ here. So why is it, we have all of this unlimited righteousness, all of these rights and privileges, and all of these blessings, all that God has done for us. Why is it that sometimes it seems like we are worse off under the new covenant than they were, I mean, especially the ones that God really used, than those that were under the old covenant?
Can I ask?
Okay, the question came up, why is that? Why is it like that? I have the answer, but I want y'all to take a step back.
I don't even want to ask that question. I want to give an example of what it is I'm saying. Right? So I'm watching like the NBA, right? And so I'm a kid, I'm a youngster, teenager, you know what I'm saying? And so I'm watching the NBA and I'm saying, how do you get there? Right? I mean, that's what I want.
Practice.
That's right. But it ain't just practice.
No, that's a
Right. It ain't just practice. It's practicing the right way.
Yeah.
Like it's a training in that. Yeah. You understand what I'm saying? Right. And so I'm trying to figure out, how do I look like David?
I was talking to a guy, a Christian today, and we was talking about the elephant, a baby elephant. And then I said, well, you know, elephants have great memories. And he was saying, well, you can take an elephant and tie his leg to a stake in the ground, and a chain or a rope, and a baby elephant put his mother over there, and he'll fight and fight and fight, hurt his leg, and then he realized, I can't get there. Then after he gets grown, you take that rope or that restraint off, and he'll still stand there and think, I can't get there.
Mm-hmm.
So his mind, his memory is telling him that from way back in the day, since way back in the day, I can't get there. And that's when the Bible says be renewed in the spirit. You got to have your mind renewed. You might get born again, but if you don't have your mind renewed,
yes,
and say that I can walk like Paul walked, I can walk like all those major characters in the Bible. If you don't get your mind renewed to that, then you just won't experience.
Well, I got that, right? So you can still say, I can. But until somebody teaches you or trains you how to do it, the elephant ain't never walked. You understand what I'm saying? He's still in the same spot. He ain't got no change, but he ain't never.
Well, I think we're born with a natural inclination to win. And if you don't suppress that appetite to win, then you'll find a way to win. And basically, it's find a way to make it happen. To find a way, and you know, if you got Jesus and the Holy Ghost helping you and so forth, you'll find a way how to win.
Right.
But then again, you also have to battle that mindset that the devil tries to put on you, that I can't win because of environmental, social, whatever, all the others. I can't. And you have to overcome and get that mind renewed and say that, oh, I know who I really am.
Okay, well, that is exactly what the lesson that I was reading about, why all of these lessons and benefits and all of these provisions and all of the unlimited righteousness and all of these sonship privileges, why is it that we still fall so far behind? Why don't we take advantage of it? And the number one reason was the unrenewed mind. The unrenewed mind. And then, see, you have to break that down. What does it mean when you said unrenewed mind? And then you have to go back to the handout that I passed out. I don't know what happened to it. No, I hope y'all still got it. The unrenewed mind is actually the product of your environment. The environment that you came out, right? The environment, then your authority figures that you have been raised up with, who had authority over you. I mean, your belief system reflects all of that. Your environment that you came up under, your ground, people that you fellowship with, that you've done stuff with, and okay, and authority figures, and then
he said that five times. Say it again.
Authority figures. Because many times, what we've been taught, it's hard for us to release that and to develop a new way of thinking and a new belief system. I mean, it takes a lot of work. Commitment to really change the way that you think, the way you believe and think. Y'all agree with that? Mm-hmm. Then repetitious information is another reason. Repetitious information you've heard. Being that you've heard it repeated, it leaves an indelible impression upon your mind. And the one that leaves the greatest impact upon your thinking is your experience. The things that you have experienced. I mean, I can say that.
Yeah.
I mean, it's hard to get away from some of these things that we experienced when we were coming up. And experiences, and these things are very, very difficult to overcome. That's the reason why renewing the mind, it takes a real diligent effort. You have to be really, really, the Bible says giving all diligence.
It takes health, too.
A lot of help.
But when I say it take help, I need you.
And I need to see somebody who's actually experiencing what I'm trying to experience.
Amen.
And so, I'm going to tell you why I brought that up, Pastor. It's because I start thinking about, Dr. King really been on my mind. Like, I don't know if he's been on y'all mind, but I start thinking about, okay, how does pastor get a church to go in the line of fire and get their mind off the fire and then to the promised land? Follow what I'm saying? And then I started thinking about me coming up. We went to church every day, seemed like it, you know what I'm saying? And it wasn't. Now the difference between me growing up and going to church every day, like, I wanted to go to church. Like, what I mean by I wanted to go to church was the youth were thinking, what is God going to do today? You know what I'm saying? And the adults was thinking the same thing. And so the exercise was it's almost like discipline in the house, right? So you learn how to do certain things because mommy and daddy told you to do it, and they held your hand for a little while until you got, until it became habitual. And then mom and daddy ain't have to tell you how to brush your teeth, when to brush your teeth, how to wash up, how to. And so I'm just trying to figure out, how did we get out of, because now we got people who don't have a place where the exercise are being facilitated. So now you go home and you hoping. You ain't really even in faith. You hoping something gonna happen. You follow what I'm saying? And so I'm trying to figure out, how do I become like David? Somebody gotta teach me. The fivefold is a process. There's an apostolic, there's a prophetic, there's teaching, you know. And so if I'm getting teaching, and I'm not, I can tell you all day, 7 times 7 is 49. You see what I'm saying? You can tell me, yeah, 7 times 7, 49. But you can't tell me how to get the 49. You follow what I'm saying? And so that's why I asked the question, because I know Jesus provided it, but I don't know how to get to it.
Yeah, that's what we are embarking upon now, because the...
I don't know if I understand you clearly or not, but that's why we have to study.
Oh, yeah.
And we have to read. And we have to be taught, and we have to change the way we think.
Appropriated
for ourselves.
All right.
For ourselves.
Okay, well, that's good. Anybody else want to jump in?
Colossians says that we have to continue in faith.
Grounded.
And not removed from the gospel.
Exactly.
From the hope of the gospel. Mm-hmm. So we've got to keep it before our eyes.
Okay. All right, everybody's speaking.
I'm not, and don't get me wrong, I'm not taking responsibility off of us.
Yeah.
What I'm saying is, you know, it's a reason why as a coach, it's a reason why as a playbook. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's a playbook. Mm-hmm. And I can have the X's and Y's and the ABCs all day, but I don't know how to execute them. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what I'm talking about. You know, you got, well, I think.
But we have a coach. Pastor Hill is our coach. Pastor Hill is our coach.
Oh, I got you. He nailed it on the head. That's why I
it takes practice.
Yeah.
And in the athletic world, the sports world, it means that you got to get out there. Right. You got to, well, the coach says I get in shape.
You got to execute.
If I run 5 laps. I ain't running five laps.
Right.
I don't feel like 5 laps. So if you'll never get in shape to so you got to run the 5 laps.
And that's what I was going to say. Exactly. We have the coach, but we still have to be obedient what he's taught us, get in our word to understand it for us. And again, everybody's light bulb will go on at different times.
Yep.
And certain things you'll understand more than others. Mm-hmm. And again, that's why we have brothers and sisters that we might need to call and worry and say, well, what I need, you know, what I need to do. Yeah, there you go. But it's here. Like I said, the information is here, but we have to learn it and apply it. And that's how we grow. And that's how you also walk in faith, because then you start seeing reactions and things that manifest, exactly, the manifestation. Then your faith gets bigger and bigger, and you go, well, that really works.
Right.
And then next time you have another situation, you go, well, that worked. So I'm gonna see what God gonna do.
It's in the doing.
Okay. Praise God.
That's it.
Okay, now in the process, let's
I'm just telling you, Sarah, when I went home, I was reading, you know, you told us to read 88, but I didn't get to 88. I got to the devotional and faith-building scriptures for greater confidence and trust in God, and all I got to the area of focus. the word of God. Mm-hmm. I read these little creative power and supernatural ability inherent in the word of God. And I'm telling you, this right here, I didn't get no fun. But these little things right here ministered, you know, they ministered to me. And I read it before, but it's just that, I don't know, it just came to me. And then it said, the living thing full of power and energy. I tell anybody they need to read 29, page 29. I ain't trying to go over what you said, Pastor Hill. But this here was, I mean, it's,
well, all of it's, it is saying about the same thing. You have to try to put it in a different form. All right. Everybody has spoken well. I think to change our beliefs. Okay, y'all watch this, and we're going to enlarge on this. To change the way a person believes is not easy, because the way that you arrive at how you believe and think comes from your environment, authority figures, repetitious stuff that you've heard all your life, and experiences. When we say experiences, that means natural experiences. Natural experiences have a tremendous impact on your belief in how you feel. For instance, like if I just chair here, if I had 10 people come and sit in this chair, and they sat in this chair and held everybody up, hit all 9 of them up, the 10th person comes and sit in that chair and they hit the flow, they go right through the, then I don't care what has transpired with the 9 that didn't have any problems, you know, sitting in the chair, but that 10th person is going to make a decision, what kind of belief system are they going to have? That chair just doesn't work for me. And that's an experience. So experience is the thing that probably has the biggest impact on you. Now, if that's true, if we have to reverse those four things that I just mentioned, number one is what? Environment. Number two is what? Authority figures. Number three is what? Repetitious information. Y'all have a handout with all this information. All right, and number four is what? Experiences. These are the things that form or shape the way you believe in them. All right, in order for your mind to be renewed, you have to what? You have to reverse that. I mean, when you come into Christ, you got to what? Get a different environment. That's reading the Bible, so you can't renew your mind in the same old environment. Come out from what? Among them, and be you what? So you have to place yourself in a place where what? You are going to what? Hear things and receive things, amen, that will what? Reshape the way that you what?
Think
and believe. And that's the reason why the inheritance that we have received is so what? Phenomenal. Because we have the ability to what? To help reshape the way people what? Think and believe. Amen. If we're thinking, right? But, you know, but you start with what? A new environment. Right, a new environment. You have to come where you can what? Really receive the word. Others are going in the same direction. Others have the same values, the same what? Beliefs. And everybody is what? Seeking more of the Lord. And everybody is praying and, you know, and doing things that will help to, you know, renew their minds. Mm-hmm. The environment is important, and then you have to have a what? A reputable, an authoritative figure that's reliable. Mm-hmm. How many know that there's nothing more reliable than what? The authority of what? The Word. Mm-hmm. How many can say amen?
Amen. Amen.
So you can't get beyond what? The Word of God.
Mm-hmm.
All right. The third thing, the pastor has to teach the word. The teachers have to what? Teach the word. Believers have to what?
Believe
and receive it and act the word and, you know, and walk it out.
Mm-hmm.
All of that is what? Very, very, very what? Important for people to begin to what? Renew their mind. That's the reason why repetitious information is so important. That's the reason why I go over the same thing what? Over and over and over and over and over. Even like tonight, I said, what? People don't like for me to just say the same thing. I just said, I put it in a different way. I said, the greatest achievement that humanity has ever seen is what?
being reconciled back to God. Yes. Everybody said, oh yeah, that's something new.
It's the same thing we just said.
All right, the second thing I'm saying, the greatest victory that has ever been won, the greatest conquest is what? Jesus, what? Defeat. He conquered all of those, what? Principalities and powers and rules of darkness that we, the Bible says that, what? These are the things that we are, what, struggling with today. But they've already been, what? Defeated. Amen. So our fight is not with these, what? Amen. These are hierarchies of Satan. Our fight is the fight of what?
Faith.
It's mainly a fight with what? Words. How many can say amen?
Amen. Amen.
So I said, that's the greatest achievement. Christ is what? Victory. Paralyzed. Defeated. Liquidated.
Now this, that's when we lose, whatever we're trying to achieve, when we lose, we blame it on who?
Mm-hmm.
Why? He didn't beat you.
Yep, that's right. Mm-hmm. All right, so that is true. All right. The third thing I mentioned was that we have received a great inheritance because Christ inherited all things, right? Mm-hmm. He turned it around and he what? He gave, shared that we are heirs of God and we are what? Joint heirs. Okay, now if you looked at those three things, those are the exact things that calls Jesus to have a name above every name. If you want to know what's behind the name of Jesus, the reason why there's so much power and authority in it, then you look at what? Those scriptures that pertains to what? The reconciliation, the greatest achievement is what? Conquest over what? Satan. And what? That great inheritance that he obtained, what? To give back to us. Those are the reasons why Jesus has a name above what? Every name. And when you really understand what's behind the name, and you've been given authority to what? To use the name, and how many know the name of Jesus will work? Amen. If we would what? Praise God. Have the audacity to what? Amen. Praise God to what? Believe in the name. How many can say amen?
Amen.
All right, but the third thing I mentioned is that repetitious what? Information. You got to hear over and over and over. But I think it's even greater to hear yourself affirm the word what? Over and over and over and over. That's the reason why we're asking you to do that. Because as you begin to affirm the word, then the direction that you need to take, the actions that's necessary in order for you to achieve whatever God has given you or whatever you're seeking. The Bible says, we shall decree a thing, and the thing that we decree shall be established, and light will what? Shine on our what? Pathway. In other words, God will begin to give you wisdom and revelation as to whatever else is needed to be done. So it's going to be a series of actions you're going to have to take in order for you to hold fast that confidence, what, steadfast until the end, to receive the prize, the blessing. There's going to be a set of actions, but the action part is going to come in result to the wisdom that you receive when you, what, affirm the word. Mm-hmm. People don't believe that when you affirm the word, stuff happens.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I mean, I've run from coast to coast with these books here, and you know, I consider when I first started out, I felt like that all of the preachers that I was trying to reach with this material were a lot better off than I was. They had bigger cars, bigger churches, bigger everything. And I felt, what, less than the least. I felt like I was not capable of what, confronting them or talking to them about the things that God had given me. So I backed off. Sometimes the car that I drove, I parked it a block from the church. But I didn't want them to see the kind of car, because they wouldn't what, believe my message. But God began to deal with me as I began to meditate and speak the word. The Lord said, well, what you have, what you're offering them, you know more about that than any of them that you consider so much what?
More.
Yeah. So much what? Are we richer and better off and established and the names and all of that. And as a result of that, you know, there's a bishop that uses the material, and he used to be the president of a college. And he says that for, you know, I'm not boasting, but things like that can really help you to see where God has brought you from. He said that when I began to study from Pastor Hill's material, I don't have to go through it deleting this, deleting that, I could just take it as is and just read it and feed it to my people. That was just, so when you begin to experience all of these successes and blessings, although your beginning might be real
small.
Amen. You're going to get confidence and boldness. And you're going to get real comfortable with your place in God. So, but you have to take action. It's a series of actions that you have to take in order for you to arrive at that place. It's like, amen, that place of breakthrough. It's a series of actions. And how do you know what to do? When you begin to affirm the word, then God will begin to send a light on your path. In other words, you begin to get creative ideas.
Yes.
Ooh, just like Sister Hill, when she did her play, she was just saying those pieces, those parts, those lines, over and over and over, and then that gave her creative imaginations on the screen of her of her mind. She began to see even in the early stages of her attempt to perfect that part, amen, how that person that she was trying to emulate, how they supposed to actually carry out.
When you get in your conscious, the part that you're acting out, will it become part of your conscious?
Subconscious.
Are you asking me a question?
Yeah.
What was the question?
Okay. Does it get into your subconscious mind when you begin to act
out? Absolutely.
Yeah.
There's no way you can portray that person unless it does.
Mm-hmm.
You become that character.
Yeah. So if we put the things of God in our subconscious, then we'll experience what we want a lot faster than
The nail on the head.
But herein lies the key. What you said is correct. If we begin to do that, like I did, but that took hours and hours and hours and hours. And it took practice and practice. When all the other girls were going out having fun on campus, I was in my dorm room going over my lines, rehearsing. And I had to go to the drama department, and we had to act it out. And when it wasn't done right, we had to do it over. So in the process of doing all that, you perfected it, and it became a part of it. Do we do that with the Word of God?
Well, see, we can go take it to our mind, but we have to understand that we got to go deeper than our mind. It has to become into our subconscious, which
that's
is waiting to receive.
Means.
What do you got up there in your mind? It's waiting for you to give it to it.
That's
subconscious.
Exactly.
Okay, I'm getting excited.
anything that you imagine, that's the reason why. There's no better way to change what you believe. There's no way method higher than meditation, and prayer. Meditation, prayer. Okay, those are the way. I mean, those are the things that because the subconscious can't distinguish between things that you actually experience in the natural from the things that you experience in your mind. The subconscious treat them all the same. In other words, the subconscious mind will always gravitate to the things that actually come up on the screen of your what, imagination. Whether it's an actual experience, you can have a dream, mm-hmm. and how many used to have these dreams? You were running from somebody that was running after you. You just running and running and running and running, running in that dream. And when you woke up, anybody had these weird dreams? Falling off a cliff?
Yeah.
All kind of these things. Something was after you, and some bad stuff. When you woke up, you said, "Ooh, I'm so glad that happened. I'm so glad." That was a dream.
That was a dream.
But your subconscious was responding to
this. Is real.
I mean, it just as real to your subconscious as what? As it would have been in reality. So that's good news if your subconscious mind, amen, will respond to what? Things that you imagine, things that you meditate, things that you speak, things that you pray, amen, and try and work towards what? Bringing that into what? Full manifestation. So meditation is very powerful. That's the reason why David contributed all of his military success and all of the things that he accomplished. He was the greatest psalmist. He was a prophet, priest, and a king, and all of the rich revelations he had, and the greatest king that Israel ever experienced, the richest king other than his daddy Solomon, than any king that ever existed. But David attributed all of that to what? Meditation. Right?
He said he would do it.
Okay, brother Wayne. Okay, 77, Psalm 77 and 12. I mean, he resorted to that last week. 77, I have it marked probably. And Psalms 112 is another one. 77. Okay, verse 12, brother Wayne, share that with us.
Psalm 77.
I will meditate also of all thy works.
Yeah.
And talk of thy doing. That's what David said. Okay, now look at Psalms 119. This is Sister Candace's favorite psalm. It's going to blow your mind when you see exactly what.
119.
But that was the key. 119, okay. Okay, David said, Psalms 119, 97. Oh, how love I thy law, it is my meditation all the day. Thou through thy commandments has made me what? Wiser than what? Mine enemies. For they are ever with me. I have more understanding than all my teachers. For thy testimonies are my what? And when we say meditation, that doesn't mean that you're just reflecting. But that means that what? You're speaking the word out so that that word can get into your what? Subconscious mind. And that is the most difficult thing that we are challenged with, is that sometimes I just feel like, I don't feel like saying this out. I know I need to, but I don't feel like opening my mouth and saying stuff. I just want to what? Think stuff.
Lazy. Lazy in the mouth.
All right, so now here's the thing. Keep on reading. I have refrained my feet from every evil way. I understand, I understand more than the angels because I keep thy precepts. I have refrained my feet from every evil way that I might keep thy word. I have not departed from thy judgments, for thou hast taught me. How sweet are thy words with thy mouth, yea, sweeter than honey to my mouth. Okay, so David's attachment, devotion, and commitment to speaking the word, meditating the word, these are the things that cause God to accelerate him and give him all of the prominence that he experienced. God, the Bible says David, the wisdom of David could be compared to the wisdom of an angel. But he got all of that through what? The meditation. That was his secret, meditation. And 35, Psalms 35 also, 35, 28, I believe. So this is Old Testament stuff. Old Testament things, but But David had that revelation way back under the old covenant. And I think that Caleb and Joshua and all of those knew the power of what? Confession. They knew how important it was that we are well able to overcome them, because they had heard what God repeatedly give them the instructions through Moses that he was going to what? Bring them into that land, and that he was going to send an angel to what? To drive them out. He was going to send hornets to what? To drive them out. And God told them that after the fourth generation of the Amorites, that what? They're going to be full right for destruction anyway. I mean, God has spoken all of that through his word. So when they said that, fear not, we are well able to overcome them, they weren't stepping out in thin air. You know, they weren't just you're naming it and claiming it. I mean, they had some foundation and basis for what? For saying what they were standing on the word of God that had been spoken through Moses, amen, in the past, numerous of times. So you got to have what? A basis, amen, before you can actually get established in what you believe. And that's the reason why believing is derived from an accumulation of knowledge. Okay, amen. Let me read this and then we're going to have to move on. Amen. This is not an everything, did I hear everything pizza? If you ever been to pizza? Hideaway? Who has everything pizza?
Everything.
At Cheesecake.
Oh, yeah.
Everything pizza.
Yeah, that's right.
Now this is not, I don't pretend this is not an everything pizza, but it's a whole lot of there's a whole lot of stuff in here that we could use that would what really enrich our lives.
While you're looking for that, let me say this.
Okay.
Things that we program into our spirit. Mm-hmm. We talk about the word, so the word. But I'm just reflecting back when I was doing acting, whatever. I can still remember some of those lines I had. And that's been over 50 years ago. Now, nobody's saying things about my age now. But that's been over 50 years ago. And I can wake up at night and somebody can say, can you give me a line from a streetcar named Desire? And I could give it to them. But the same is true with the word. And now, how many of us, we learned the 23rd Psalms when we were kids. And you don't have to think, like I said, the Lord is, but we know that. That's because we learn and we program it into our spirit, just like you mentioned about the timetable. We know those. And do something.
Okay, Psalms 35:28. My tongue shall speak or meditate of thy righteousness and of thy praise.
Where are you?
All the day long.
Psalms 35:28.
Psalms 35:28. And my tongue. That's under the old covenant. He realized how important were the things that were coming out of his mouth. It's so important. And my tongue shall speak or meditate of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long. This is page 22, Sister Church, 22, 23. Those probably been my favorite spots too. 22, 23. Everybody got a special, but you got a long ways to go to cover this book now.
I know, but I just got nothing.
I mean, this whole book, we should make an effort to what? To meditate the whole book, because the first part of it is dealing with holiness.
Mom's example is like perfect. I'm just talking about acting. I'm just saying like, and I said this before. Sometimes we see this book as a story. We don't identify in Jesus. You know what I'm saying? And so I think if we act like Jesus, I mean, if we actually That's what David is doing. He ain't say his righteousness. He said thy righteousness. You know.
And after I pray.
We cannot identify with it unless we have spoken it over and over and over again. Amen. Sister Hilma said that she was in there and studying what everybody was doing, going over and over and over again. And when she did it wrong, there was nothing to convince her that she wasn't an actress. She just went back and got it right. And she said, that's what David said. I've meditated and I am not departed. I've kept your ways.
Exactly. It would be something if this only worked for David.
But it works for whoever it works.
But David had a following that turned out to be some awesome people. His following, if you hung around somebody talking like this, then you start doing it.
That's right.
And it rolled off on them, and David's support system or whatever, that crowd that followed him came out to be some very wealthy people.
You see, you gotta make a concerted effort. Now, I'm going to tell off on Pastor Hill. Well, we eat out quite a bit, and generally, most of you know, when the waiter or waitress come to your table, they'll say, I am Candy, and I'm going to be your waitress for the night. I make a concerted effort to say, okay, you're my man, two or three times, this is Candy. Candy. And I'll ask him, what's our waitress name? I don't know. But that's because he didn't make a concerted effort to try to learn. I mean, to retain that.
Yeah. Okay, I got something else to say. I always leave good tips. So
Hey, watch this. What was your name in the play?
Blanche.
See, it wasn't Miss Hill. No. You see what I'm saying? Mrs. Hill. It was what?
Blanche.
See? And so I ain't David. I'm Jesus when I is thy. You follow what I'm saying? We don't identify in him like we should. Mm-hmm. We got to play the part.
Yes.
Yeah,
yeah.
You
got to
act
the
role.
Play the part.
Good.
Act it out.
Yeah. You said it good. Play the role. That's good.
Man. Okay, we are embarking up on a consecration, and we want to maximize our efforts, so we have given you an assignment to do page 88, if you just start with integrity of the word. And you look at the integrity of the word, that's really important because that's the covenant that God has made with you, that he will always what? He will always stand behind his word to what fulfill it. So we have a blood covenant with the Lord also. And the reason why those men were men of valor, and they did all these prodigies, even David's men, they were miracle men. But they were what? Blood covenant. They were blood covenant relations. That's the thing. I mean, they had something special going for them anyway. Because God had what? Pledged with an oath to what? To be everything that they would ever need. That's the reason why all of the miracles and the supernatural and all of the interventions that we see in the Old Testament, because they were God's blood covenant what? People. And I believe that we have a better covenant, right?
Yes. Yeah.
We have a better priesthood. We have a better sacrament. We have a better blood. And it's all built upon what? Better promises. So we have a greater promise. So I want you to really, because the benefits of our redemption are going to be reflected in those pages that we have labeled building the highest type of faith. And that could be, that's how the ministry of writing was released into my life through meditation. So whatever you want to birth is going to begin with what? Meditation. Because that's the thing that's going to what? Give you the what? Establish you in your belief so that God can actually begin to what? Bring those things into fruition that you have visited. Okay, Now, I'm going to ask you to meditate these mightily. Start speaking them forward. The second reason why believers don't act on all of their rights and privileges, not only because the unrenewed mind, but secondly because of fear. F-E-A-R. F-E-A-R. And the only way you can overcome fear is through what?
Faith.
Yeah.
All right. Fear not, be not dismayed. I am your God. I will what? Strengthen you. I'll help you. I'll uphold you with the right hand of my righteousness. That sounds like a blood covenant statement. I'll uphold you with the right hand of my what? Righteousness. Okay, so the only you overcome fear with an action happen. You got to act, because I was scared as I could be when I first started trying to present my material. You know, I was even afraid to pick up the telephone and call somebody and ask them if I could come and present my material. That was fear. But I overcame that by what? Acting. And began to what? To do. And as I began to act and step out, then I got more bold, more confident, and I began to get established in the work that God had given me. So that is very, very, very important. Okay, and the third thing they mentioned, fear, after fear, was that a low level of fellowship. That means that that there is no spiritual, very low spiritual initiative, motivation, zeal. You know, that is what we call low level of fellowship. So the reason why we are asking you to really get involved in meditation and speaking the things out is because getting intimately acquainted with God through His Word is the thing that you can reverse all of these negatives that hinders us from stepping out and actually taking our place as sons and daughters in the kingdom of God. We have to find a way to overcome fear. We have to find a way to overcome what? Spiritual inactivity. In other words, when there's very little praise, little actually affirmation, things that can motivate you and put fire in your bones and really turn you on the inside, you got to find some way what that you can get a what spiritual release on a consistent basis. David said, I'll meditate the word all day and I'll praise him all day. From the rising of the sun till the what? Going down of the saints. But that is the thing that hinders and holds back the people of God. Spiritual initiatives. Spiritual initiatives. Amen. Fear. And let me throw this one in. Laziness.
In the mouth.
a lazy lip, a lazy mouth. How many guilty? I know. We'll read the word. Everybody reads the word every day, right?
Negative.
But how many going to open their mouth and what? Read and say it. Sometimes I say, I know I need to be reading this out loud, because when I read it out loud, it just resonates in my what spirit better. But I just say, oh, I've had a hard day, long day. I just don't feel like working my mouth. I don't feel like working no more. Not even my mouth. All right. Well, we overcome by the what? Blood of the Lamb. That's what Christ has done. Everything that he what? He's going to do. Except for the high priestly work that he's consistently doing. So we have to keep the balance of, grace is what God has done for us over 2,000 years ago, plus what God is actually doing for us at the right hand of the Father, what, right now. But in his mediatorial position as high priest, amen, the number one thing that he's supposed to be doing as a high priest is handling your, what, prayers and your, what, confessions. And if you ain't offering those things up to God continuously, then what? He can't operate in that capacity. He's there to handle your prayers and the words that you present to him, amen, that's based on the provisions that he has what made for us. They got to offer it up on a continuous basis.
Praise God.
All right, done.
You're done.
Consecration, meditation. The second thing, the consecration is going to be what? Abstinence from food. And we got some songs that we're trying to get people singing. I have a whole book, a whole list of songs, S-O-N-G-S. And one of them is, I have seen the downfall of Satan. I have seen the victory of Jesus. Glory be to God. Amen. When I look to my left, I see Satan has fallen. You ever heard that? When I look to my left, I see Satan has fallen. When I look to my left, I see Satan. Okay, and then when I look to my right, I see Jesus has conquered. So we want to sing songs that will what? Reflect the redemptive realities that we're still now. We got a whole book of these that we are what? Passing out free. We want you to what? Sing them, and we want singers to pave the way. And singing these to the glory of God so we can catch
you. Oh, I just wanted to say, piggyback upon something Sister Irene said earlier, that there is a reward for doing this. You know, like she was saying, that when you experience one victory and you encounter another problem, then you look back and see how God brought you through that, then you know there's a reward. And we got to begin to look for that reward. And then we got to continue to press, because I just was reminded that, and I say this humbly, that all the work that I did in the Dramatics Club and all that, and it required a lot of time. And I said, I don't want my grades to plummet, but I graduated with honors. And but at the same time, that year that I did all of that, I received the Best Actress of the Year award. Mm-hmm. Best Actress of the Year. The Oscar. I got the Oscar award that year. But that was a payoff for all the hard work I put in. So there's a payoff for the work we do, that we put in. It's not, but no, it's not just wasting time just because the pastor asked us to do it.
All right, the meditations are very important in this consecration. I don't want to go into consecration with empty minds, empty heads, and people that's not committed to the word. Just the way you're just going through a hunger strike. if we ain't got nothing working. I think that you ought to have something working, right, in order to what, get the full benefits of what you're going to be what doing. You ought to be singing it. You ought to be what, saying it. Is that right? We're going to have all of these things into operation. So Sunday I'll have all of my... Plus I have a lesson that deals with the redemptive work of Christ. Everything that I have taught is in a lesson that relates to our redemption. And all of those points I've been making. You got a lesson that you have to work through. So if you didn't get it while I was teaching it, then you can go back and what? Work it out little by little by little by little. I want you to be doing all of that during your consecration. And we'll see what happens after the consecration is over. What kind of prayer?
I got a suggestion of a song you can sing during offer or receiving. Maybe not tonight necessarily, particularly on Sunday morning. Mm-hmm. Not me leading that. get that out there straight through real quick. Jehovah Jireh, my provider. My great sister, I don't know how I'm saying it right, so that's why I say I don't want you to want me to lead it. But Jehovah Jireh. Did anybody know that song?
Jehovah Jireh. It's in the book that we have. It's in the book that we're gonna be passing out. We have it listed as an offering song. One of the offering songs, but we got some performance songs. That's good.
Worship.
You want to sing it for us?
Oh, no.
We'd be, then we'd be cheerful, Kim.
God shall supply all my needs.
Father, we thank you for your grace, your grace is sufficient, able to cause all grace to abound toward us, so we will have sufficiency in all things. In Jesus' name, amen.
What?
Thank you, everybody, for the, in case there'll be a moment.